Welcome, dear listeners, to the Carolina Haints Podcast, brought to you by Wreak Havoc Productions and A Darker World. I'm your host, Dan Sellers. Normie. That's the name that's been given to the alleged monster that lives in Lake Norman. Descriptions vary, but most witnesses agree that Normie is a 20-foot fish-like creature with a dorsal fin, flippers, a slender body, and long whiskers. But other reports range from a large Lake Placid-sized alligator to a three-humped snake-like beast, similar to the Loch Ness Monster. Ironically, there's a circumstantial link between Normie and Nessie. During the Battle of Culloden in the 16th century, thousands of Scots were forced to flee their homeland. Eventually, they came to America and settled in Pennsylvania. Later, they migrated south to the Lake Norman area. Is it possible that one of these refugees smuggled a baby Loch Ness out of Scotland to bring to their new home at Lake Norman? That would be a no. Lake Norman didn't exist when the Scottish settled in North Carolina. Lake Norman isn't some ancient body of water left behind from the last ice age, like Lake Champlain or Loch Ness. And stories of Normie do not span back centuries like Bigfoot or any other cryptid legends. Lake Norman is man-made. Duke Energy built the Cowans Ford Dam in 1963 as part of the McGuire Nuclear Power Plant. This flooded the valley and created Lake Norman. Most of the Scots' land is now underwater, along with countless buildings, a couple dozen bridges, and many, many graveyards. And no, in most cases, the bodies were not relocated. Several historic Revolutionary and Civil War battlegrounds were also submerged, as well as sacred Native American sites. Lake Norman covers 32,500 acres. It touches four North Carolina counties and has 520 miles of shoreline. That's more than the coastline of North and South Carolina combined. It holds nearly 3.5 trillion gallons of water, but experts say that's still too small to support a large aquatic monster. By comparison, Lake Champlain and Loch Ness are both considerably larger. If you fill a 5-gallon bucket with water and have that bucket represent Loch Ness, then the 4 trillion gallons in Lake Norman would account for just 2 tablespoons. And Lake Champlain, Champ's home lake, holds 70,000 times the volume of Lake Norman. If Lake Champlain was a 50-gallon drum, Lake Norman would be 0.5 teaspoon. One sighting of Normie comes from a man that was scuba diving in the lake. Knowing that many homes and buildings were left intact when the lake was formed, some people will dive these sites in search of old bottles or such that they can sell. After consulting maps from the 1920s, the man and his buddy dived the lake. They found a group of 3 buildings. One looked particularly promising, as the glass and the windows were still intact. They found a hole in the wall and prepared to enter the structure. They turned on their lights and looked inside. What they saw stunned them. It was a huge fish. The man didn't know what kind of fish it was, but he said that it was at least 8 feet long and had a 3-foot wide mouth. As you might have imagined, that was the end of their scavenging trip. Another young man claimed to be tubing on the lake with his dad. The young man fell off the tube and his dad made a wide circle to come back around for him. As he did, they both saw a large neck emerge from the water that stood about 5 feet into the air. The sight terrified the young man, but not as much as it did when the neck once more disappeared below the surface.
Where is it?
He asked himself. And is it hungry? The man swam as fast as he could to meet the boat, but neither he or his father saw whatever it was again. Another man told a Normie tale from high school. Him and his friends would go out into one of the bridges and dive off the trestle into the water. They were there a couple of hours splashing around and having a good time. The man climbed up the trestle and jumped off again. When he surfaced, his friends were yelling for him to get out of the water. He looked behind him and saw the wake of something large below the surface of the water. He got out of the water as fast as he could. Whatever it was never broke the surface. But the man said he could see a giant 14-foot-long shadow beneath him. There are some pretty fantastical theories out there for what Normie may be. Some have alleged that the nuclear power plant inadvertently created some sort of 1950s horror movie mutant fish. Others claim that Normie is some kind of guardian, summoned by the desecration of the sacred Native American sites. There have been more than 50 UFO sightings over Lake Norman since the power plant opened. So, of course, a small number of people think they put something in the water. But most theories are a little more down to earth. Normie is most likely a very large variety of unknown species, like a sturgeon or big eel. Some reports say that it looks a lot like an alligator. Maybe it is. Alligators aren't generally found that far inland, and the waters of Lake Norman are thought to be too cold for the reptiles. However, smaller 5- and 6-foot alligators have been pulled from Lake Norman in the past, and other non-native species have also been found, including a pacu, a South American species closely related to the piranha, along with the small, strange jellyfish. But the most likely culprit for the Normie sightings is a catfish. The largest catfish have been known to get 10 feet long and weigh 700 pounds. Certainly big enough to be considered a monster. It brings a whole new meaning to the phrase catfishing. But residents near Scape Ore Swamp, South Carolina, may have a visitor that no plausible explanation can account for. On July 14, 1988, a boy named Chris Davis was finishing up his shift at a fast food restaurant in Camden, South Carolina. It was a little past 10 o'clock when he left. He was nearing his hometown of Bishopville, deep in the heart of Scape Ore Swamp, when Chris got a flat tire. He pulled over to change the tire, and just as he was finishing, he heard something crashing through the swampy forest. Chris looked up to see a 7-foot-tall lizard with green scaly skin and glowing red eyes. To make things worse, the beast was running straight at him. Chris slammed the trunk and jumped into the car. Chris's parents weren't sure what to make of the story. Surely there was a logical explanation. But when other people started coming forward with their stories, they took Chris to Sheriff Liston Truesdale to report his encounter. This is Chris's official statement. Quote, "It was about 25 yards away and I saw red glowing eyes. I ran into the car and as I locked it, the thing grabbed the door handle. I could see him from the neck down. The three big fingers, long black nails, and green, rough skin. It was strong and angry. I looked in my mirror and I saw the blur of green running. I could see his toes and then he jumped on the roof of my car. I thought I heard a grunt and then I could see his fingers through the front windshield. They were curled around the roof. I sped up and swerved to shake the creature off." End quote. as you may imagine, Sheriff Truesdale was even more skeptical than Chris's parents. He said it was probably a bear's eyes reflecting the red from the brake lights. Bears in that area will often climb on top of cars. But there were more reports. George Holloman was out riding his bike late one night. He stopped for a cigarette, and as he sat there, looking off into the woods, he thought he saw one of the trees move. He watched it carefully, but saw no other signs of movement. Then, a car drove past. Its headlights lit up the area. Holloman saw the eyes of a creature standing in the tree line. It was staring back at him. He jumped on his bike and pedaled as fast as he could. Thankfully, the creature did not give chase. Another report was made in confidence to the sheriff by a good friend of his. The man requested anonymity because he was also a well-respected colonel in the army. The evidence was mounting. It was too much for the sheriff to ignore. Meanwhile, the locals had given the creature a name: the Lizard Man. Sheriff Truesdale took a group of deputies out to the area where his friend, the colonel, had claimed to see the creature. They searched the area and found strange three-toed tracks. The tracks led deeper into the Scape Ore Swamp. Even the dogs couldn't track anything through there. In fact, it was that very inhospitable terrain that gave Scape Ore Swamp its name. It was said that slaves could scape over the swamp because the landowners couldn't track them through the muddy earth. The sheriff called in the state boys for assistance. The extra manpower couldn't track whatever the thing was through the swamp, but an expert on tracks analyzed the three-toed prints and determined that given the stride and depth of the tracks, they could not have been faked by any human. By now, the Lizard Man of Scape Ore Swamp was receiving national attention. Every reporter in the country wanted an interview with Sheriff Truesdale. He agreed to come on Good Morning America and tell the town's story. Dr. Eric Beckjord, director of the Cryptozoology Museum in Malibu, said that the most likely culprit is a Bigfoot that is covered in green swamp algae. Strangely, the site began to dry up after that. But the Lizard Man of Scape Ore never fully went away. Every few years, there would be a new sighting, fueling the public's curiosity and keeping the legend alive. In 2017, a couple of weeks before the solar eclipse, the South Carolina Emergency Management Division issued a strange announcement. They tweeted a map of all the Lizard Man sightings over the years and, quote, "This historical map is in response to recent media reports about possible paranormal activity associated with the upcoming total eclipse. SCEMD does not know if lizard men become more active during the solar eclipse, but we advise the residents of Lee and Sumter counties should remain ever vigilant." End quote. Now, most likely, it was a stunt to increase tourism in the area. This was just a couple of years after the CDC released its zombie preparedness guide. But then again, as the second tweet said, quote, "Regarding possible paranormal activity potentially during the #SolarEclipse2017. As always, if you see something, say something." End quote. To learn more about these stories, check out John Hare's Monsters of North Carolina, Mysterious Creatures in the Tar Heel State. Also Terrence Sipke's Best Ghost Tales of South Carolina. Check out LakeNormanMonster.com, Newsweek.com, OnlyInYourState.com, as well as unknownexplorers.com. This episode was researched and written by Jeffrey Cochran, and is narrated and produced by me, Dan Sellers. If you enjoyed this show, please feel free to check out all our other projects. We're on Facebook and Instagram at Wreak Havoc Productions, and I'm on Twitter at Hank vs. the Undead. You can find every episode of our show and everything else that we're up to at our website, wreakhavocproductions.com. Don't forget to check out adarkerworld.com for updates on Jeff Cochran's work. And feel free to email us your questions and suggestions to wreakhavocproductions@gmail.com. Don't forget to subscribe to the Carolina Haynes podcast on iTunes. Please share it with your friends and leave us a review. We'll be back in 2 weeks with another episode. Tune in then to hear more about those things that go bump in the night.